Turn with me to Hebrews chapter 8, and I want to start reading with verse 1. The Bible says this: Now the things which we have spoken, this is the sum. We have such an high priest who is set on the right hand of the throne of the majesties in the heavens, a minister of the sanctuary. The word minister there means a high priest of the sanctuary. The word sanctuary there means the holy things, the prayers of the saints. A minister of the sanctuary and of the true tabernacle which the Lord pitched and not man. For every high priest is ordained to offer gifts and sacrifices, wherefore it is of necessity that this man have somewhat also to offer. For if we were on earth, he should not be a priest, seeing that there are priests that offer gifts according to the law, who served under the example and shadow the heavenly things, as Moses was admonished of God when he was about to make the tabernacle. For see, saith he, that thou make all things according to the pattern showed to thee in the mount. But now hath he obtained a more excellent ministry. Everybody say excellent ministry. By how much also he is the mediator of a better covenant, which was established upon better promises. Why do you have it better today than the ministers that started out with Jesus? Because you have a better covenant and a better promise. See, and everybody's trying to get you to go back to what they went through. You see, they're thinking, well, bless God, you got to want. And they take Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and they preach this stuff like that. That is for us in terms of a New Testament church. No, no, we have a better covenant and a better promise than the prophets of old. Now, you got to understand something. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John is Old Testament. It's chronologically put in the New Testament, but it is actually Old Testament. The New Testament did not start till the book of Acts or the church as we know it today. That's why it starts off in Acts chapter 1. All theophysis. You start talking, telling about the things that Jesus began to do. Then it started the church as we know it today. I want to deal with what Jesus is doing now. He has four jobs. His number one job is what Hebrews 8 says. He's a high priest. He's a high priest. The Bible said he's a priest touched with the feeling of your infirmity. He's a high priest. That's his number one job. That's how he became a more excellent ministry with more excellent promises, with more excellent covenant. Number two, he's a mediator. He introduces the lost man to his father. Number three, he's an intercessor. Now, why do you need an intercessor since you're born again? Because some of the crazy things you do. And number four, he's an advocate. Why would we need an advocate or a lawyer? Because we got an accuser of the brethren called Satan accusing us. Now, this is what Jesus is doing right now at 8:28 on a Tuesday night. This is what he's doing. And I want to go through this. Now, I did this. I preached this in Jamaica. And it took 5 days, so get ready. I'll try to condense this as much as I possibly can. What I think of people, oh my God, hallelujah. What I'm saying is, what is Jesus doing today? Number one, he is a high priest. He is a minister or a high priest of the holy things. In other words, he is the person that brings the prayers and brings them to the Father. He said, ask anything to the Father in my name, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. His number one job is that he is a high priest ministering the holy things. Now, what does that mean? Sometimes we don't pray right. He takes our crude petitions in worship and makes them beautiful to the Father in his name. We have done some of the worst, crudest petitions in worship you've ever saw. And you ever heard this statement that the Holy Spirit was grieved because you were crudely worshiping him and crudely using his name? So number one, he takes our crude petitions in worship and makes them beautiful to the Father. Most of us pray wrong. Amen. You notice you pray a prayer and you get it back answered. It's a little different because you don't pray in line with the Word of God. Here is a crude petition. Here is a crude prayer. And I said it last night, I'll say it again. It's a woman that's religiously brainwashed instead of New Testament taught, and she wants her son or her daughter or her husband saved. Now, here's a crude petition. She said, God, I ask you, Lord, whatever it takes, save my boy. Whatever, Lord, whatever it takes. If you got to break his legs and blow his eyes out, Lord, and rip his head off and burn the skin off his skull, Lord, I lay him on the altar. Get him saved. And the Lord gets this. He goes, oh, I can't do this thing. I got to fix this, glory to God. I'm not going to present that to my father because that's totally unscriptural. Don't shout me down when I'm preaching good. See, that's a crude petition. Lord, kill our pastor. He can't do that stuff. You want to know how you get rid of your pastor? There's three ways you can get rid of your pastor. It's so simple. My God, when he calls a work day on Saturday, everybody show up. He'll have a heart attack in the foyer. That's number one. You can get rid of him that way. Number two, give him the biggest raise you can ever give him. My God, he'll eat himself to death in 6 months. You got him on them starvation wages. Number three, go tell every other church in town how great your pastor is, and somebody will offer him a job. That's pretty good, isn't it? So number one, as a high priest ministering the Holy Spirit, we pray some of the dumbest, stupidest prayers you ever heard or God's ever heard. And then Jesus gets it. He goes, I can't believe. Oh, let me fix this. And he has to fix it and make it beautiful to the Father in his name. He didn't come to kill, steal, and destroy. That's amazing to me why people have church splits. Because the people that leave think they're going to heaven. The people that stay think they're going to heaven. What happens if they both go to heaven? Another church split. No, if you can't get along here, how you going to get along there? Don't shout me that because it's the same love. So number one, he is our high priest. He takes our crude petitions in worship and makes them beautiful to the Father in his name. I have prayed some dumb prayer. Here's another dumb prayer. Lord, if you let me win this sweepstakes, oh God, I will give you lie you fry. You win $10 million. You ain't giving God $1 million. He can't get a dollar on your $10. How are you going to get $1 million? That's a crude petition in worship. That's a bald-faced lie. How many times have we prayed selfishly? You know what the Lord says? He said, pray for those that despitefully use you. Most people don't pray like that. My Lord, some woman steals your husband. Just rips him out right out of your hand, man. Ah, makes you mad. You don't pray for that man the way God told you to pray for it. No, or that woman, especially that woman. You say, Lord, I'm coming to pray about that woman. Kill her, God! Kill her! Kill her! If you don't want to do it, let me do it. Just blind the cops so they can't catch me. But I'll kill that honking woman in a second. That's a crude petition. Now watch this. He's a high priest. So he takes these crude petitions in worship and makes them beautiful to the Father. So, see, sometimes you get your prayer answered, but it's not answered the way it's prayed. Why? Because you're praying wrong. He had to fix it. Because he will not introduce anything that's not in line with the Word of God to his Father. Because why? His name's on it. See, that's the difference. His name's on it. So he's responsible. The Lord is just as responsible for that prayer that he presents to the Father in his name. He ain't going to put his name on something stupid. I want you to think about that. And you know, we spent centuries preaching against, my God, dresses and makeup and long hair. Isn't that the weirdest thing you ever heard of? I said this last night. Remember when a sleeveless dress was a sin? A sleeveless dress.
Sin! Sin!
My God, boy, if an armpit turns you on, you need deliverance. You need to come down here. Get God to save your life. There's something. That's terrible. I ain't never seen a woman. I ain't never looked at a woman's armpit and went, I mean, my God, son. Most of them got that white powder stuck up in there, man. I don't want that. Glory to God. But yet they preach that foolishness and trash while people were dying and going to hell. People dying and going to hell, everybody worry about armpits. Or an elbow. I mean, lady, have you ever had a man grab trying to get your elbow? Good Lord. Isn't that amazing? But you men could wear the top fashion of the day, but your wife had to put a flour sack dress with hair on her legs so she could be holy. And I found out when I went to Pentecost, the church, about the only thing they could do was eat. And boy, did they eat, son. I'm talking major eating here, bless God. They'd dance in the spirit and stop, and their body'd move for about 2 minutes. Till all of it kind of calmed down a little bit, bless God. Jumping on somebody because they're smoking cigarettes and they're 50 pounds overweight. Don't shout me down when I'm preaching good. Thank you for that Holy Ghost grunt. Come on, listen to me. So when you prayed those prayers, oh God, that old cigarette sucking devil from hell, the Lord said, look at this, man, I ain't presenting this junk. Why? Because he's a high priest. That's his number one job. He takes his crude petitions in worship. He makes them beautiful, the Father. In that high priest position, he is touched with the feeling of our infirmities. Now, why is he touched with the feeling of our infirmities? Because he goes to the Father and said, by my stripes, they are healed. He's not sending you something to teach you something. I've had people say, God sent this sickness to me to teach me something. I say, well, you better hurry up and learn because you're dying. See, that's silliness. And that's a theological, homiletical, hermeneutical, religious excuse. Because, see, they don't know what to say. You understand what I'm saying? What actually is happening, it's a prayer of faith on a foundation of fear. That person's going to die, and God's going to get blamed for not healing them. That's exactly what's going to happen. But my Bible says, as a high priest, he's touched with the feeling of our infirmities. In other words, if you hurt, he hurts. I'll never forget one time, when you understand the difference between divine healing and divine health, the difference is fellowship. See, you know what God is. I went into my study to pray. Boy, I mean, I was feeling good, and the ministry was going good, and everything going right, and I just went in there and said, oh, Jesus. I just call him Jesus. He called me Jesse, you know. Both our names start with a J. Something spiritual about that. I don't know what it is, but whatever. I just went in there, and I just ministered unto the Lord, boy, and I just praising the Lord, enjoying myself. I wasn't at my office, just in my study. I have a study, you know, desk and all that kind of stuff in my home. And boy, I'm just standing, sitting in there and walking around my study, bless God, and just praising the Lord. And like I normally do, just enjoying myself. And then I realized something was wrong. I said, something wrong. And it ain't me. What are you saying, Brother Jesse? You saying something wrong with God? Yeah. Well, that got you quiet, didn't it? Look, everybody. I knew something was wrong because I know God. He wasn't acting the way he was normally acts. Something was wrong. And it wasn't with me. I got everything was okay. Great. Glory to God. Finally, I realized. I said, somebody hurt you today. Didn't they? You hurt him. I know it. I can sense it. I fellowship with you. You're not acting the way you normally act. You are hurt. And I said, Lord, I'm going to cancel all my appointments. I'm going to shut everything down today, and I'm going to praise and worship you and love you and hug you. And Lord, for a lack of a better statement, until you feel better, something's wrong. And the Lord spoke to me. He said, boy, you know me. I said, did somebody hurt you today, Jesus? He said, yeah, my people disobeyed me. They hurt me. You see, his capacity to love is way greater than your capacity to love, but his capacity to hurt is way greater than your capacity to hurt. And when we hear this statement that we grieve the Holy Ghost, we flow over that like that's nothing. You hurt his feelings. Now let me ask you a question. Have you hurt him today? He's a high priest. He's touched. I realized the Lord was hurting. He needed my love. So I just praised and shouted and canceled everything and just loved him. I said, come here. Let me just hug you a little bit, bless God. You know, I said, Lord, just so, for lack of a better word, so you can feel better. I don't know how else to say it in my natural mind. I just want to bless you. All of a sudden, it wasn't in the morning, about 30 minutes after I did, I heard the Lord go, thank you. Oh, you made my day, Jesse. He said, you can go back and do your appointments now. I said, you okay? That sounds strange to you? Shouldn't. It's called fellowship. That mama knows when that kid's something wrong with that baby. That baby ain't said nothing. That mama says something wrong with that kid. Kid ain't feeling good. Something wrong. What's the matter? Now the daddy goes, oh, kid's feeling fine. No, something wrong. Something wrong. Am I telling the truth, ladies? You know it immediately. So immediately you begin to tend to that child. Well, come on. You feel bad? What's the matter? See? You see? Why? Because you touch with their feeling of infirmity. Think about that next time you want to disobey God. Don't hurt it no more. See, he's a high priest. He's touched with the feeling of our infirmity, as well as taking our crude petitions in worship and making them beautiful to the Father. I'm going to do this as a teaching session tonight, because normally I'm a preacher. Now, what else he does as a high priest? He has separated us from Satan's kingdom. Now, that is so wonderful. I wish religious people would believe that. I don't know how they can sin so easy lest they go jump into the kingdom of Satan. The Bible said we're crucified, and nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. Paul said, I'm crucified with Christ. Crucified. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ that liveth in me. And the life which I now live, I live by the faith of the Son of God. Well, what kind of faith Jesus had? Do a study of that. Who loved me and gave himself for me. Then the next verse says, I do not frustrate the grace of God. Think about that. He separated me. So when the devil says, Jesse, your future's bad. You're going down, boy. You're not going to make it. I tell you what, you this. I said, whoa, whoa, devil, stop. Whoa, 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 whoa. Let me read you your future. Let me show you where you're going to burn, boy. Come over here. I'm going to want you to see this earlier. Just real good. Just show it to him. Boy, he don't like that, see. He said, I'll make you do this. I said, you can't make me do nothing. Why? Because I have a high priest that has separated me from your kingdom. The only time I can do anything with you is when I get in the flesh. But if I crucify daily instead of Sunday, I'll not fulfill the lust of the flesh. That's his number one job. So how many times you've been praying wrong? How many times you've hurt the Lord, didn't even realize it? Yet even through that, he separated you from Satan's kingdom. Listen to this. He has obtained eternal redemption and carried his blood. Why couldn't Mary touch Jesus when he resurrected? My God, if she would have touched him, he'd have had to do it over. And then the old covenant, they had to tie a rope around that high priest. He'd go in there, bless God, and if he sinned, it's like they drag him out. And Jesus looked at, I'm going to show you what this woman did. Women have done more things. They have caused, they've shut down more things than anybody ever seen in my life. One woman with an issue of blood shut down Jairus' healing for his daughter, and his daughter died, and Jesus had to raise the daughter. Because she said, if I could but touch the hem of his garment, bless God, shut Jesus down. He's trying to get to Jairus' house. This woman said, forget it, Jack. I'm getting my healing. Shut Jesus down, and then all of a sudden Jairus gets the message, don't bother the master, your daughter's dead. And it was a woman done it. And what happened to Jesus when he died? My God, the Bible said he put all principalities and powers. He obtained eternal redemption. My God, he just resurrected. He's about ready, bless God, to go to heaven to pour his blood upon the holies of holies and declare man to be made the righteousness of God. Then Mary showed up and shut down redemption. Shut it down, made me wait. Made you wait. He saw she is hurting. He's touched. He's about ready to put on his high priest cap. And my God, she don't recognize it. And he said, woman, you know, what's your problem? She said, where have you laid him? She's coming to take care of the body. Well, my God, he had 110 pounds of weight on him. I mean, she couldn't have carried his body. There's no way she could have done it. I mean, with the two or three other ones, she couldn't have done it. I mean, they'd have had to drag Jesus out, just dragging him down the road. Finally, he looks at her and says, Mary. Oh, my God. When he says, Mary, she goes, Jesus! He said, whoa, woman, control yourself. I'm paraphrasing it. Whoa, stop. Don't touch me. I have not yet ascended. See, she shut down redemption. Why? Because he saw a person hurting. But ready to go to the throne, wait, even made his father wait. He said, I got to take care of Mary first. He takes care of Mary. He said, Mary, go tell him I'm alive. That's all you got to do, son. She said, no problem. And she hooked it down that road, brother, and gave her the greatest proclamation that ever came out of any human being's mouth. He's alive! He's alive! She went to hollering. Glory to God! Woo! Running down that road, everything she had. And guess what? She's an ex-prostitute. Good Lord, why didn't he tell Peter to say it? See, because he's no respect to person. Then Jesus said, man, I got to get to heaven, my God. So he just takes off to heaven, pours his blood upon the holies of holies. My God, angels shout. He declares before his Father, man's been made the righteousness of God. My blood has washed away every sin. The word of God, sin, has been declared defunct because of my power. Now watch this. Now watch this. You think he'd hang around and go to the party? He said, listen, I got to get back down there. I'll see y'all later. He zooms back down there. And his father said, but we got a party, man. My God. He said, listen, I got to get back to the earth, talk to my friends. See, I'll be back after a while, about 40 days. See you later. Wham! Down he goes again. There come a bunch of women. They saw him, David! And they just grabbed him and touched him and fell at his feet. But notice this. He shut redemption down to help a lady because she was hurting. That's that high priest job. Think about that. He'll shut the world down to get to you. He'll do what he has to do to get to you. My God, man, that ought to make you shout. I tell you what, you know why? Because you got clout. You are the apple of his eye. The Lord loves you. I say that all the time. I said, the Lord loves me. He can't help himself. I can tell. I know it. Man, he gets around me. He want to hug me. I say, you want to hug me? Go ahead. You can hug me. Like, just want to bless me. My Lord. Why? Because he's that high priest. That's his number one job. See? He's obtained eternal redemption, not some redemption. In other words, there's mercy and grace even if you mess up. Everybody messes up once in a while. Peter messed up one minute he's praying, the next minute he's cussing. Sound familiar? Don't shout me down. You can have a Holy Ghost power pack punching service. My, you can have Renee going, ooh, boy, and then them high heels knocking a fire out that Italian marble, boy. Bing, boom, 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 boom. Then you go park behind our car and she can't get out. What's the matter with these crazy people? No, no, I can't get by my car. You're going to have a Holy Ghost service and want to kill somebody in the parking lot after you leave. And the Lord goes, no, look at him down there. How many of y'all have done it? Don't lift your hand, ma'am. Keep your hand down. Women are honored. Yeah, boy, I like to kill a man last night myself. You seen these guys trying to park you and you don't do what they tell you to do. You go turn where you want, you see them guys. I want to let you know they ain't speaking in tongues, I'll tell you that much. So what's happened? That's crude petitions God's got to fix. So number one, he's a minister of the sanctuary, a minister of the holy things. He's obtained eternal redemption. He separated me from Satan's kingdom. He's touched with the feeling of my infirmities. He takes my crude petitions in worship and makes them beautiful to the Father. I can't lose with that kind of person working for me. He's a high priest. He loves me. That's why I'm not a condemned man. That's why I take the book of Romans, bless God, apply it to my life. There's therefore now no condemnation. Righteousness is not how you look. Righteousness is right standing in your heart with God. You understand with me? I mean, it makes no difference what people think or what they say. It's what Jesus says. I've had people say, I don't believe that. You said that. I said, I didn't say that. I just repeated it. Jesus said it. Jesus said it. I guess you believe in healing when you're sick. Well, yes, why not? Because that's the answer to the sickness. But there's a point in life that you can stop the sickness. Uh-oh, we lost a few right there. How that's done? Fellowship. Get so close to God that disease stay away from your body. I got a friend of mine. She's about 98 years old. She told me, she said, I don't think I'm going to die, Brother Jesse. I said, why? She said, because every time I get sick, I get healed. She said, I've been trying to get out of here for 25 years. She said, 98's a long time. I said, well, just get married and have another baby. Why not? Well, why not? I met a man that was 96 and his wife was 93 years old. He drove his car to my meeting. His wife looked about 59. He looked about 62. He was 96. And she was 93. And I said, what's your secret to health? He said, don't you know what the word of God says? I said, yeah, I think I know. He said, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge, my God. In him will I trust. I mean, I thought, this old man got it together. So I made a joke with him. I said, you planning on having any more babies? And I thought he was going to bust out laughing. He didn't even crack a smile, him and his wife. He said, we're thinking about it. Glory to God. What did he say? He that dwelleth. He didn't say he that visiteth. Ladies and gentlemen, that was years ago. He came to my meeting last year. He's 104. She's 101. He's still driving his car. And he looks like about 70.
I'm looking for little ones to be around him. You know, tell him. Blessed isn't it? He understands God's word. He understands this high priest. He's separated from Satan's kingdom. He's a blessing to God. The oldest person to ever visit one of my meetings was last year in Stafford, Texas. Full Gospel Church, Richard Ford. Anybody know Richard? This woman come up to him. She said, I enjoyed your message. I said, well, thank you, ma'am. I appreciate you coming. She said, how old you think I am? I hate that when people say that stuff. Because you want to be. Now, because I'm not offended. You know, people think I'm 48 to 52. I'm 43. Hey, I've had people ask me if Kathy's my wife. If she's my daughter. Of course, she just women love that stuff. Women are so worried about looking old. I mean, that's why they're always rubbing themselves with something. You ever seen that? Women just rubbing themselves with something. Man, my God, they always got grease on them. Man, I hugged Kathy the other day. Phew, went right out my arms. I thought, it's slippery all the time. That's just something rubbing itself or something. And they don't mind sharing that stuff. I mean, I was on a plane just the other day. This woman takes out this tube, squeeze the whole bunch, start rubbing. And I'm sitting in the aisle seat. This woman's sitting in the middle. This other woman said, they don't know each other. I mean, we don't know each other. She goes, man, she got too much. So she looks at the woman. She said, you want some? The other one went, yeah, I'll just take me some of that. And don't even know the person, my God. And they're swapping hand lotion with each other. That little lady looked at me and she said, how old you think I am? I thought she was about 70. So I was going to be nice and say 68. She was 108 years old. I said, I know your secret. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High. She said, that's a fact. I saved when I was 3. I believe she's going in the rapture myself. High priest. That's his number one job.
Thanks for listening to this powerful message by Jesse Duplantis. Remember to hit like, subscribe, and the notification bell in order to be up to date with all things Jesse Duplantis Ministries. For more information, visit our website at jdm.org.
This media is copyrighted by Jesse Duplantis Ministries for the private use of our audience. Any other use of this media or of any pictures or accounts without Jesse Duplantis Ministries' consent is strictly prohibited.